चलो। हेलो एवरीवन, हाउ आर यू ऑल। तो राइट नाउ वी विल टेक विच चैप्टर फॉर रिवीजन? फाइनेंशियल इंस्ट्रूमेंट। ऑलरेडी वी हैव डन द पार्ट वन ऑफ दैट। वी हैव कवर्ड रिलेटेड टू इंड एस 32। तो नाउ इन आवर पार्ट टू ऑफ दिस रिवीजन वी विल टेक द recognition and measurement of financial asset, recognition and measurement of financial asset, correct? So that will be as per which Ind AS? Ind AS 109. As per Ind AS 109, already we have done the meaning of financial asset, correct? Now for recognition and measurement, the financial asset has been classified in how many category? Three category. Financial asset measured at amortized cost, financial asset measured at fair value through OCI, financial asset measured at fair value through PL, correct? Means there will be three category of financial asset for the purpose of not presentation. Presentation will be current, non-current in our balance sheet. Means this classification we are doing for recognition and measurement criteria. For recognition and measurement criteria. Now the question is that on what basis the classification will be done? The classification is done on two bases. First is what? Contractual cash flow characteristics. Means can I say the financial asset will be either it will be solely the payment of what? Interest and principal amount, or it will be not related to what? Payment of principal or interest amount. So it is based on contractual cash flow characteristics. Means whenever you are doing classification, first you need to identify whether it has some contractual cash flow characteristics. If yes, then it will be one set of category. If no, it will be other set of category. That we need to understand which category. Second, it will depend upon business model, intention of management, for which purpose we are holding it. So there can be three purpose. Either we hold to collect contractual cash flow till maturity, or we hold to collect contractual cash flow and sale whenever required, or sale whenever required, or it will be held for the purpose of what? Trading. Means it will not be hold for the purpose of collecting contractual cash flow. It is only for the purpose of trading, means to earn some speculative or short term profit, correct? Understood? Or any other business model, or any other business model. Now the classification of financial asset will be based on ki this financial asset is what for other entity. So can I say the financial asset of one entity will be either financial liability or equity instrument of other entity, or equity instrument of other entity. When I say financial liability, then we can say it is a debt instrument of other entity. When I am saying equity instrument, means it is equity instrument of other entity, correct? So we all know that if it is a debt instrument, there will be always contractual cash flow. When it is equity instrument, there will be no contractual cash flow. Therefore, classification, first you identify whether it is equity instrument of other entity or whether it is debt instrument of other entity. So can you say if it is a debt instrument of other entity, first we'll apply what? Contractual cash flow characteristics test. If not fulfilled, means if the contractual cash flow characteristics not fulfilled, then it will be always measured as what? FVTPL. It will be always measured as FVTPL. Means can I say whenever there is no contractual cash flow characteristics, it means it is held for the purpose of trading. It is held for the purpose of trading. Whenever it is held for the purpose of trading, it will be always classified as FVTPL. When contractual cash flow characteristics has been fulfilled, then after that we'll apply business model test. Business model test means we need to find out the intention of management, for which purpose it has been held. So can I say either it will be held to collect contractual cash flow. If it is held to collect contractual cash flow till maturity, then it will be classified as what? Amortized cost. Okay. Second, if it is held to collect contractual cash flow and sale whenever required, then it will be classified as FVTOCI, but it will be FVTOCI with recycling. With recycling means what? The cumulative gain or loss which has been transferred to be OCI will be recycled to PL on derecognition, correct? Understood? And if it is neither hold to collect contractual cash flow till maturity, or it is not hold to collect contractual cash flow and sale whenever required, correct, then it will be measured as what? FVTPL, or FVTPL option can be selected initially. FVTPL option can be selected initially as per the what intention of management. If selected initially, then we will measure at what? FVTPL. Correct? Understood? This point. If it is equity instrument of other entity, can I say then there will be no contractual cash flow? There is no contractual cash flow characteristic. The question of contractual cash flow will not arise. So can I say will not identify contractual cash flow in this case? Means can I say normally equity instrument of other entity is held for the purpose of trading. If it is held for the purpose of trading, then it will be always what? FVTPL. If it is not held for the purpose of trading, then we say it is held for some strategic purpose. If it is held for some strategic purpose, then it can be either measured as FVTPL or FVTOCI option can be selected. FVTOCI option can be selected. So if FVTOCI option is selected, then it is what? FVTOCI. If FVTOCI option is not selected, then measure as what? FVTPL. Correct? Already I have discussed that in this case there can be two type of investment in equity shares. When I am saying investment in equity instrument of other entity, means investment in equity shares normally, so it can be either investment in equity shares of subsidiaries, joint venture or associate, or it can be of other entity. Correct? So if it is investment in subsidiaries, joint venture, associate, then it is not covered under Ind AS 109. So it is not covered under Ind AS 109, specifically excluded from Ind AS 109, because for this Ind AS 27 is applicable. Means we are discussing about those investment in equity shares which are not for subsidiaries, joint venture or associate. So normally it is held for trading, but suppose it is for some specific purpose, some long-term strategic purpose, then it can be measured as FVTOCI, but that FVTOCI will be without recycling. Means the cumulative gain or loss will never be reclassified to PL on derecognition. Correct? Means for recognition and measurement, we have four types of what? Financial assets. First, measured at what? AC. Second, and measured at FVTOCI with recycling. Second is what? Measured FVTOCI without recycling. And third is what? FVTPL. Correct? Understood. Now, initial recognition of AC will be done at fair value plus transaction cost. For FVTOCI will be done at fair value plus transaction cost. For FVTOCI without recycling, fair value plus transaction cost. But for FVTPL, only at fair value, transaction cost will be transferred to PL immediately. Correct? Can a subsequent recognition means on reporting date, the AC will be measured at AC. AC means amortized cost by applying EIR. Can I say the fair value through OCI and fair value through PL will be measured at fair value. Correct? Understood. And the fair value gain or loss, can I say in case of amortized cost, there will be no fair value gain or loss, not applicable. But in case of FVTOCI and FVTPL, this fair value gain or loss will be transferred to OCI, PL. OCI, and PL. Correct? Understood. Means can I say in case of FVTOCI, whether with recycling or without recycling, this gain or loss will be accumulated in OCI. It can be given as a fair value gain, as a fair value reserve. So you can open one account, we used to open revaluation surplus account, we can open one account, fair value reserve account. Correct? Understood. Okay. Interest and dividend. Either interest or dividend income. Can I say in case of AC, it will be recognized by applying EIR and will be transferred to PL. Can I say if it is FVTOCI with recycling, it means it has contractual cash flow. It means here it will be also transferred to PL and will be will be recognized by applying what? EIR. But in case of FVTOCI without recycling, because it is what? Equity instrument, there is no contractual cash flow. If there is no contractual cash flow, there is no question of EIR. Means here, it will be transferred to PL, but once it is received, means once dividend has been received from investment in equity shares, it will be transferred to PL, but it will not be transferred to OCI, even though it is FVTOCI. Means interest and income will be always transferred to PL, whether it is FVTOCI, whether it is ACA. Can I say, if it is what FVTPL, there is no question of interest in dividend. So whatever gain is there, that is what? Always considered as what? Fair value gain or loss. So can you say, in case of FVTPL, because it is held for trading, there was no intention to earn interest income or dividend income, therefore it will never be treated as what? Interest income or dividend income. Are you getting what I am saying? Correct? Understood? Means, if I am saying AC, to be write down what? To bank, then we write down to interest income by applying EIR. This will be transferred to PL. Then by bank, this will be contractual cash inflow. Then this will be by balance carried down. And this closing balance will be known as what? Amortized cost. This is AC. If it is what? FVTOCI, debt instrument, means with recycling. So can I say here, means I can say it is investment in debenture. Investment debenture which is measured at FVTOCI. Then can I say, we write down to bank, then to interest income by applying what? EIR. Are you getting what I am saying? Now you are understanding everything. EIR. This will be transferred to what? PL. Okay. Then we write down by bank contractual cash flow inflow. And then we write down by carried down at fair value. And any difference will be what? OCI or OCI. So this is fair value gain or loss. This is fair value gain or loss. When I am saying FVTOCI without recycling, means I am talking about investment in equity shares. Okay. So can I say, we write down to bank when you have purchased, including transaction cost. This will be including transaction cost. Okay. But whether there is any contractual cash flow? So can I say no contractual cash flow? No contractual cash flow. But can I say dividend can be received? Yes. Dividend received. So once dividend received, this will be what? This will be transferred to PL. So we can directly transfer it to PL. We can directly transfer it to PL. If I want to route it through this account, or directly we can pass one journal entry, bank account debit to dividend income. I am doing one account so that you can understand ki by whatever dividend received is transferred to PL. Are you getting what I am saying? So dividend received will be transferred to PL. You can route it through what? Investment account, as separately one entry you can pass bank account debit to dividend income. Means can I say if this is 10, so this will be also 10. So automatically this is right now this amount only, and there is no contractual cash inflow. But batao, closing balance will be what? Fair value. And difference will be what? 2OCI and by OCI. So dividend income is transferred to PL once received. Understood? If it is FVTPL. Means any investment which are held for the purpose of trading. So without two bank cost. Correct? Can I say whatever amount we are receiving by bank? Correct? This will be whether it is interest income or whatever contractual payment. If received, so okay, but there is no contractual cash inflow. If received, okay. Correct? Whether this will be treated as income? नो बाबा नो, करेक्ट, बाय कैरिड डाउन एट व्हाट फेयर वैल्यू एंड डिफरेंस विल बी ट्रांसफर टू व्हाट दैट पीएल. आई एम राइटिंग ओसीआई, यू आर आल्सो सेइंग ओसीआई. डिफरेंस विल बी ट्रांसफर टू पीएल, दिस विल बी फेयर वैल्यू गेन और लॉस. मीन्स इवन द इंटरेस्ट इनकम और डिविडेंड इनकम इज रिसीव्ड दैट विल नॉट बी treated as separate income, it will be automatically adjusted in this gain. If you are writing separately also, both will be transferred to PL, therefore your SOPL does not affected, it remain unaffected, it remain unaffected there. But we don't write dividend income because there is no intention to earn dividend income. So whatever dividend income you have received, whatever interest income you receive, that is only considered as recovery of cost, recovery of cost. Itna mil gaya. Understood? You have received, and difference will be a fair value gain or loss, which will be transferred to what? PL. Therefore, we have written what? We have written what? Yahan par ki interest or dividend income is not applicable. So, if you are receiving some interest because you have purchased some investment, that will be only considered as what? Recovery of cost. Recovery of cost. Understood? Understood this point? Correct. Then gain or loss on derecognition will be transferred to PL. Correct. This will be transferred to, this will be transferred to PL. This will be transferred to OCI. This will be transferred to PL. Correct. Why gain or loss has been transferred to OCI for FBT OCI without recycling? Because it will never be transferred to PL. And can I say, in case of debt instrument which is measured as FBT OCI, the cumulative gain and loss in OCI will be recycled to PL on derecognition. Correct? But if it is without recycling, cumulative gain and loss will not be recycled and remain in equity and transfer to what? Retain earning. It will remain in equity. Correct? Means in this case, we'll pass my journal entry. If suppose OCI has a credit balance, if OCI has a credit balance, so my journal entry will be OCI account debit to PL. And if OCI has a debit balance, then journal entry is what? PL account debit to OCI. So it is reclassified to PL as a reclassification adjustment. But in this case, we'll pass the journal entry OCI to retained earning and retained earning to OCI as the case may be. OCI I'm writing, you can give a name of fair value reserve. Fair value reserve. Understood. Means it will never be reclassified to PL. It will never be reclassified to PL. Understood this point? Correct. Any doubt? So this was what? Initial recognition. Initial recognition as well as subsequent recognition. Any doubt? No doubt. Correct. Then for initial recognition, we have done one special point. If for initial recognition, the accounting can be done either on settlement date or on trade date. Means a financial asset will be recognized either on trade date or settlement date on initial recognition. And if you are following settlement date accounting, some adjustment is required on reporting date. Remember, for example, ki you purchase one investment in equity shares on 29th March 2018 at rupees 100. Correct. And on 31st March 2018, it become 102. Now, generally what happened ki even though we have done transaction on 29th March, but the physical delivery of this asset will be received in our demat account after 2 days. Means it will be received on 2nd April 2018, and on this date it might be 103. Correct. So what they are saying, either you can recognize a financial asset on trade date or you can recognize financial asset on settlement date. But because you are following settlement date, some adjustment is required on reporting date. So for example, if we follow trade date accounting, so on 29th March, what will be the journal entry? Financial asset account debit to payable. Generally, amount will be deducted on settlement date. Correct? At rupees 100. But if you are following settlement date accounting, no entry yahan par. Theek hai? But can I say, if this is measured at fair value, either through OCI or PL, either through OCI or PL. Correct? So you recognize some gain in case of what, traded accounting. So can I say your journal entry what, financial asset account debit either to OCI or PL. Huh? If it is amortized cost, then no adjustment required, because for amortized cost we never do fair value measurement. Are you getting what I am saying? So this journal entry will pass either through PL or through OCI, as the case may be. But batao, if you will not recognize this gain, how much gain? 2. It can be 2 lakh, it can be 2 crore. If you will not recognize this, if you are following settlement debt accounting, so can I say, if an entity is following trade debt accounting, if other entity is following settlement debt accounting, these are non-comparable. Because of that reason, what India says, if you are following settlement debt accounting, even though you are recognizing financial asset on settlement date, recognize this gain on reporting date. Means you will pass one adjustment entry. What you'll do, you'll open one account, fair value adjustment account, debit to OCI or PL. How much? 2 crore. 2 crore. Understood? So whenever you are following settlement debt accounting, some adjustment is required on reporting date. On reporting date means they have given an option, either you follow trade debt accounting or you follow settlement accounting, but you are following settlement accounting, some adjustment is required on reporting date. If T plus 2 is falling into reporting date, two different reporting period. Understood this point? This also we have understood. Okay. So we have done recognition. Recognition, we have done initial recognition, we have done subsequent recognition. Then we'll come to reclassification. Means, can I say during the tenure, it can be reclassified from what? From one category to another category. Correct? Okay. Now, reclassification will be always done on prospective basis. It will never be done on retrospective basis. So can I say, what are the three situations? Reclassification of amortized cost to FBTOCI or FBTPL. Either AC will be reclassified to FBTOCI or FBTPL. Why reclassification? Because intention management change. Initially, it was intended to hold till maturity. Now it is held for the purpose of trading. It is quite possible not. Correct? So if intention change, if business model change, then reclassification need to be done. So there are 3 points: measurement value, gain on loss on measurement, remeasurement, and third is what, EIR. What will be the effect in effective interest rate? Correct. So can I say, if it is what, AC to FBTL, then measured at fair value on reclassification date. Fair value means gain due to reclassification will be transferred to PL. And EIR, can I say for FBTPR, EIR is not required or not relevant? So not applicable. Correct. If it is AC to FBTOCI measured at fair value on reclassification date, gain or loss will be transferred to OCI. And can I say for FBTOCI we require EIR because it has contractual cash flow. So EIR will be same EIR, no changes in EIR. So no adjustment due to reclassification, it means use original EIR. Use original EIR. Means whatever EIR you are using for amortized cost, same EIR you need to use it. In class we have done one question for proving this. Correct? Understood? Correct. Then reclassification of FBTPL. So FBTPL can become AC or FBTPL can become OCI. Okay. So once again, measurement at what? Fair value on reclassification date, fair value on reclassification date. But if it is FBTPL to AC, the gain or loss will be transferred to PL. But if it is FBTPL to what? FBTOCI, gain or loss will be transferred to PL only. Are you getting? Not to OCI. Because can I say up to reclassification date, the gain belong to which category? FBTPL category. So we are not applying retrospective, we are applying on prospective basis. So on the date of reclassification, whatever fair value gain or loss is there, that is in which category? FBTPL category. Can I say FVTPL there was no EIR, but for AC or FVTOCI we will require EIR. It means EIR need to be computed. So EIR need to be calculated based on what? Fair value on reclassification date. Means can I say we'll find out the discount rate at which present value of remaining contractual cash flow will be equal to fair value on reclassification date. For both same. Very easy. Correct. Then reclassification of FBTOCI. This is thoda sa interesting. So FBTOCI can become AC or FBTOCI can become FBTL. First we'll do FBTPL. So can I say reclassification will be done at fair value on reclassification date. Gain or loss will be transferred to OCI. Correct. Now can I say if it become from OCI to PL, to whatever cumulative gain or loss will be reclassified from OCI to PL. Therefore entity will, entire OCI will be reclassified from equity to PL as reclassification adjustment. But for FVTPL, do you require EIR? No EIR, not applicable. I think this too you understood. Correct. Now FVTOCI to AC. FVTOCI to AC. So once again, reclassification will be done at fair value on reclassification date. Fair value gain or loss will be transferred to OCI. Correct. But whatever cumulative gain or loss which was accumulated in OCI will not be reclassified to PI. It will be adjusted with what? Fair value on reclassification date. And once you adjust it with fair value on reclassification date, then automatically the FVTOCI will become AC from the beginning. From the beginning. As if it was AC from the beginning. It does not mean that we are applying retrospective. Huh? We are doing prospective. But whatever accumulated gain or loss in OCI will not be reclassified to PL. It should not be reclassified to PL because it was not FVTPL. So it will be adjusted with what? Fair value on reclassification date. As you have done such adjustment, it will be measured at as if it was AC from the beginning. AC means amortized cost. And so removed from equity and adjusted against fair value on reclassification date due to such adjustment. Due to such adjustment, financial asset is measured at AC on reclassification date as if it has been always measured at AC. And EIR, no adjustment required, means same original EIR will be used for AC. Correct? Understood. Means if you have OCI debit balance, if you have debit balance, then what your net will pass? Will do what? Financial asset to OCI. It will be adjusted with what? Fair value on reclassification date. Adjusted with the asset account. And if OCI has a credit balance, the journal entry is what? OCI account debit to financial asset. For this also I have done one proving by taking one example in class. I think you have understood. Correct. So this was reclassification. Correct. Understood. So we have done initial recognition, we have done subsequent recognition, then we have done reclassification. The last point will do what? Derecognition. So derecognition when? Can I say the financial asset will be derecognized if any one of the conditions satisfied. First, contractual right to receive cash flow has been expired. Means if it was hold till maturity, so on maturity date, automatically contractual right to receive cash flow will be expired. So automatically it will be derecognized. Correct. Or entity has transferred contractual right to receive cash and also has transferred all the substantial risk and reward related to the ownership of such asset. Risk and reward has been transferred means what? If there is a chances of bad debt, the bad debt will be borne by transferee. The bad debt will be borne by the person who has purchased the asset. So it means risk and reward has been transferred. So if risk and reward has been transferred, then it will be derecognized from our balance sheet. Second, sometime what happened? We will retain the contractual right to receive cash flow on behalf of the other party. Means we have transferred the asset, but we retain the contractual right to receive cash flow. But as soon as we receive contractual right, as soon as we receive cash inflow, immediately we'll assume an obligation to pay what contractual cash flow to that party. means we retain, we'll collect on behalf of other party and we'll transfer to the other party as soon as we receive. And all the risk and reward has been transferred. Correct? Means we have transferred the asset, but we are collecting on behalf of that party. Then also it will be derecognized if risk and reward of such asset has been transferred. Correct? Understood. So can I say, when I am saying risk and reward has been transferred, it means the entity should not retain any control of financial asset transfer. There should not be any control. Correct. So no control should be retained. Correct. So can I say in this way, if a risk and reward has not been transferred, but asset has been sold, so it should not be derecognized. The asset will be continued to be recognized in our balance sheet. But in that case, whatever consideration has been received, that will be considered as financial liability. Financial liability. So what they have said, if the entity has retained substantially all the risk and reward, and the entities, then entities should continue to recognize the transfer asset in its entirety, means it will not be derecognized. And whatever consideration has been received, it will be recognized as financial liability and will be recognized at what? Amortized cost. Understood. So you have sold the asset, but you have not transferred the risk and reward to, you have received some consideration, the journal entry reward, bank account debit to financial liability. And that financial liability will be recognized at amortized cost. Amortized cost. Understood. Accounting treatment. So we have done for complete derecognition. What journal entry? Bank account debit to financial asset. Any gain or loss will be transferred to PL. Now, one thing you have understood, if it is FBT OCI debt instrument, then OCI will be reclassified to PL. If it is FBT OCI equity instrument, then OCI will be transferred to retained earning. That entry you have understood, that I am not writing. That I am not writing now. Correct? Understood this point? If there is a partial derecognition, partial derecognition means some portion of asset has been transferred. So can I say every asset has two portions, contractual interest payment and contractual principal payment. So sometime we transfer some part of the cash inflow. So if some portion of cash inflow is transferred, it means we will recognize the asset to the extent of portion not transferred. To the extent of portion not transferred. So I will write down one compound entry, bank account debit. With consideration received, with consideration received, then principal strip retained, then interest strip retained, then servicing asset, remember, servicing asset to what? Financial asset, correct? This is total carrying amount and this is what? Carrying amount of asset, carrying amount of portion retained. Carrying amount of portion retained. Retained. Correct? And this is the fair value of consideration received, fair value of consideration received, any gain or loss will be transferred to PL. Okay? So in this I have given some step. First is what? Step number one is what? Find out fair value of financial asset. Correct now? Find out fair value of financial asset. So this will be equal to fair value of principal component and fair value of interest component. Discounted at what? Discounted at current market rate of interest, means expected yield of, I have said what? SP means what? Special purpose entity. If you remember debt securitization, I have said तो एक्सपेक्टेड यील्ड रेट ऑफ स्पेशल पर्पस एंटिटी दैट विल बी गिवन इन द क्वेश्चन. तो विल फाइंड आउट प्रेजेंट वैल्यू ऑफ प्रिंसिपल पार्ट, प्रेजेंट वैल्यू ऑफ कॉन्ट्रेक्चुअल इंटरेस्ट पार्ट डिस्काउंटेड एट दैट यील्ड रेट, दैट विल बी व्हाट फेयर वैल्यू. देन स्टेप नंबर टू, एलोकेट कैरिंग अमाउंट इन द रेशियो ऑफ व्हाट, इन द रेशियो ऑफ फेयर वैल्यू. To find out principal strip retained, to find out interest strip retained carrying amount. So entire carrying amount will be allocated in the ratio of what? Fair value. In the fair value. Then we'll pass journal entry. Then we'll pass journal entry. You remember this point? Correct? Okay. This also. Then at the end we have done continuing involvement of entities in transferred asset. Continuing involvement. So sometimes what asset is transferred? Risk and reward is also transferred, but entity would have some continuing involvement in that asset by giving some guarantee. Means even though risk and reward is transferred, but they retain some control. They retain some control. That is known as continuing involvement in the asset transferred. Correct? Continuing involvement in the asset transferred. So what they said in this case, if the entity neither transfer nor retain risk and reward of the asset, neither transfer and retain control of the transferred asset, then entity continue to recognize the transferred asset to the extent of what? Continuing involvement. Means it will only recognize asset to the extent of continuing involvement, means to the extent of guarantee given. And that continuing involvement will be equal to what? Carrying amount of asset transferred or fair value of guaranteed amount, whichever is lower. Correct? Whichever is lower. Carrying amount of asset transferred or guaranteed amount, whichever is lower. Okay? Means what joint will pass? First joint will what? Bank account debit to financial asset, consideration received, this is carrying amount, gain or loss will be transferred to what? PL. Then we recognize one asset, that is continuing involvement asset, to what? Financial liability, associate liability, we call it associated liability. This joint will be done with what? Carrying amount of financial asset transferred or guaranteed amount, whichever is lower. Okay. Now, whenever you give guarantee, you also receive some consideration for guarantee given. Means, can I say total consideration will have two part. One is consideration for asset transferred. One is consideration for what? Guarantee given. So, this journal entry is done for without consideration for asset transferred. But some consideration you receive for what? Guarantee given. So that will be what? The third journal entry, bank account debit to associated liability with the amount of what? Fair value of guarantee given. And this fair value of guarantee given will be amortized to PL over the period of what? Guarantee. Over the period of guarantee. Understood? That only have it. Also recognize associate liability, which is initially measured at guaranteed amount plus what? Fair value of guarantee. They got total liability will be what? Guaranteed amount plus what? Fair value of guarantee given. So associated liability will be equal to guaranteed amount plus fair value of consideration received for guarantee given. But the fair value will be transferred to PL during what? Guaranteed period. It will be amortized in guaranteed period. This we have done for derecognition. Only last point. Now we have done AC, amortized cost. Okay. Now normally what happened? If it is at market terms. Market terms means what? It is at market rate of interest. Correct. Means financial asset has been what? Loan has been given or any receivable is there. It is at market rate of interest. Correct. Then can I say fair value will be always equal to transaction price? Understood this point? Correct? And if it is at off-market terms, off-market terms means at lower rate of interest or subsidized rate of interest or no rate of interest. Okay. It means in this we need to calculate fair value. The fair value will be what? Present value of? Fair value will be what? Present value of contractual cash inflow discounted at what? Discounted at market rate of interest, which will be given in the question. And can I say there is some difference between transaction price and fair value? The difference will be accounted separately. Will be accounted separately. Will be accounted separately. Correct? Understood? Can I say this difference, if there is no future economic benefit, means this is the extra amount paid, if there is no future economic benefit, so it will be charged to PL as an expense immediately. But if there is some future economic benefit, means some condition has been given, so can some future economic benefit received within some period, so it will be what? Considered as prepayment. Prepayment, and this prepaid will be amortized during the period of future economic benefit. During the period of future economic benefit. Correct? This you understood? Okay. Then, one more point we have done. Some loan, sometime what happens, subsidiary has given loan to holding company and holding has given some loan to subsidiary company. If it has a market rate of interest, then no doubt. But if it is at off-market terms, correct? So can I say in the books of holding company, means who has given loan? Subsidiary has given loan to what? Holding company. So in the books of subsidiary company, given. Here also given. Okay. So holding company has given loan to subsidiary company. So what joint will pass? So can I say what will do? Financial asset account debit to bank. Can I say it will be at fair value? This will be with total amount. Difference will be considered as investment in equity instrument in this case. You remember this question? Okay. If it is at not, if it is not at market terms, if it is at market then to over, then no difference will arise. Okay. If it is loan from subsidiary to holding, so what joint entry? Financial asset account debit to what? Bank. Correct? So this is at fair value. This is the total. Difference will be what? Difference will be what? Dividend distributed. Dividend distributed. Which will be transferred to retained earning? So it will be considered as deemed dividend. Deemed dividend. So can I say in the books of holding company you can consider it fair liability, and in the books of holding company this will be dividend income. Dividend income. Understood. And in the books of subsidiary company this will be what? Equity instrument. It will be equity instrument. Understood. This question also we have done. This type of question. So with this I have tried to cover all the points of financial asset. Only one thing is left. Impairment loss. That we'll do in some other part. Okay. Today this much only. Thank you very much. We'll meet tomorrow with next part. Okay? Okay.